So my name is Noomene and Henda. I work at Ericsson Research, and this is a joint work with my colleague Karl Norrman. For those who don't know, LTE stands for long-term evolution. It is the most recent standard for the fourth generation of mobile communication systems, also known as 4G. Okay, so in this talk, I will first start by giving the motivation behind this work. Then I will talk a little bit in general about the formal verification of security protocols. After that, I will describe a little bit LTE networks and some aspects related to security. Then I will present our modeling approach using a formal verification tool called ProVerif. And finally, before I conclude, I will discuss the verification results. Okay, so let's start with the motivation. Well, the first argument is obvious. I mean, telecom protocols, they are widely and massively deployed. Design errors detected after deployment, they are in general difficult and very expensive to correct. Standardization process could greatly benefit from the use of formal techniques. And last but not least, I mean, formal verification of security protocols is a very active area of research in academia, leveraging many popular tools. Okay, so let's talk about formal verification. Well, security protocols or procedures, they are in general based on message exchange between agents or peers, allowing them to share secrets over public networks. Such procedures, they are intended to work correctly even in the presence of an intruder or an attacker. And by correctly, we mean that they need to guarantee properties such as secrecy and authentication. So we are actually interested or focusing on an approach which is symbolic. And in this approach, or this approach relies on the symbolic model of attacker called the Dolev-Yao model. And this attacker model is defined basically by two assumptions. And the first one, we assume that the attacker has full control over the communication medium in the sense that it can intercept all messages. It can forward, drop, or replay all messages. And the second assumption is that we assume that cryptography is perfect. And this means that the attacker cannot decrypt messages unless he has the required decryption keys. Okay, so there are many difficulties when doing formal verification. So basically, we would like to prove correctness regardless of the number of agents involved in the protocol and regardless of the number of runs. There might be other sources of infiniteness. Basically, if in the protocol model you use entities which has infinite domains like timestamps or counters. Scalability is another issue. We would like to handle large protocol models, not only two agent models. And this is typical in telecom networks. The usability is also another difficulty because, I mean, what can you do if the tool doesn't terminate? I mean, can you get some assurance from the analysis so far? And then if you think about it, there is no alternative really, because if you think about testing, what would you do? Shall we wait for the protocol to be implemented to test it? And in case you choose to do that, how would you simulate the attacker? Okay, so what we did is that we selected different security procedures from the LTE standards, and we used a tool called the ProVerif to model and verify secrecy and authentication. This tool is developed in RIA. Yes, okay, so I'm going to talk a little bit about LTE networks now. The goal of LTE is to provide user equipment, this can be a mobile phone, with a stable IP address, allowing him to connect to the internet. Although the mobile device or the user equipment is moving across the networks. Okay, so the user equipment connects to the network through the radio access network, and that's basically a set of base stations called eNode Bs. Each eNode B is connected to two nodes. The first node is the MME one, and this one manages the control plane. And the other node is called the serving gateway, and that node manages the user plane, basically the traffic between the user equipment and the internet. The MME node is connected to another one called the HSS node, and this one holds all the users or subscribers information. Okay, so now from security perspective, so the trust model in LTE is as follows. We assume that the core network is physically secure, and this basically means that the attacker has no power there. In addition, we assume that the eNodeBs, although they are deployed in public places, they are physically secure so that no one can tamper with them. If we lose this trust, then we lose everything, basically. And now LTE relies on different keys depending on the procedures, depending on the agent involved. I mean, these keys, they are organized in a very specific key hierarchy. So at the root of this hierarchy, you find the master key. This is the one which is stored in the SIM card. This is actually the key provided by the operator. And it is shared between the user equipment and the HSS node. When the user equipment or the device attached to the network, basically when you start your phone, there is a procedure which is run, and this procedure basically derives another key called the COASME key. This one is shared between the user equipment and the MME node, and it's going to be used to derive other keys in order to activate security for a protocol called NAS. This is one of the protocols in the protocol stack. Yes, and this COASME key in its turn is going to be used to derive another key called KeyNodeB, and this one is shared by the eNodeB, which is actually serving the user equipment and the user equipment itself. This key is going to be used to derive other keys that are going to be used to activate security for yet another protocol called RRC, and also it's going to be used to derive encryption keys for the user plane. Okay, so now I'm going to present our modeling approach using ProVerif. The language of the input language of ProVerif is a typed variant of the Pi calculus, for those who are familiar with this. Messages are modeled as terms, and cryptographic primitives are modeled as functions or rewrite rules. Processes are basically defined as sequence of events, and the security properties are declared as queries. So I will illustrate this by an example. Okay, so typically a ProVerif input model can be divided in three parts. In the declaration part, you find things related to user types, communication channels, constants, cryptographic primitives, queries, etc. And then you have the process macro part, and that basically each process macro is a parameterized process definition, which is defined by a list of events. There are different types of events, events for sending data, events for receiving, etc. And finally, the third part is the main process, and there we have the process macro instantiation. You can think about it as the process macros are like the class definition, and the main process is the main function where you instantiate your classes and use them. Okay, so this is the example I'm going to use for illustrating how we model. This is the X2 handover procedures involving four nodes. You have a user equipment, two eNodeBs, and an MME node. And the topology looks like this. So initially, we assume that the MME and the user equipment, they share a key called COASME, and also we assume that those three nodes, they share a key called KNodeB and a set, which we refer to as the UE args. This set basically includes the set of, for example, encryption algorithms that are supported by the user equipment. It's also called like the set of capabilities of the UE. One more thing is that those parameters have been established by procedures which are run earlier. So we assume now that they are given and ready to be used. What happens now is that the user equipment moves away from the source eNodeB towards a new target eNodeB. And when the source eNodeB detects that, it will derive a new key using its parameters called KeyNodeB star, and then it will send a handover request message to the target eNodeB containing those parameters. Now the target eNodeB will select one of the capabilities from this set and will send back and we send back a handover command reply containing this selected algorithm, and then the source E0B will simply forward it to the user equipment. Now, the user equipment knows which algorithm is supported by the target E0B. It used also the same parameters to derive the E0B star and sends a completion message to the target E0B. And now, the final steps are that the target E0B will send a path switch request message to the MME telling him or notifying this node that he this E0B is the one actually serving the user equipment. Upon reception of that, the MME will derive a key called nexthop2 key and will send it in an acknowledgement message to the target E0B. This nexthop2 key is going to be used for deriving other E0B stars for other handovers from this target E0B. Okay, so what would the declaration part in a model of this procedure look like? So basically, we would need some declaration related to channels to model the communication medium. I will not talk a lot about the syntax, but I hope you'll find it familiar. And then we'll need some key type to model all the keys involved. We need also some kind of alg and algorithm set type, and also function to construct such type, such sets in order to model these UE algs, which are sets of capabilities. We need also some kind of a message header type and constant of this type to model all the messages that are involved in this procedure. I mean, this is a good practice because using such tags will restrict the number of possible behaviors in the model and will increase the chances of termination when we run the analysis with ProVerif. And we need also other function declaration to handle encryption, hashing, whatever is required for the model. Okay, when it comes to the process macros, basically what we do is that we introduce a macro for each, to implement each role of each agent involved in this procedure. I'm going only to consider these two. So basically the declaration looks like this, where we pass the parameters that define the initial context as arguments to the macro. And now what happens at the procedure is that the source E0B will derive a key called E0B star, and this is implemented like this by the let syntax, and that basically means, okay, let's create a new variable of type key and bind its value to what's on the right-hand side of the equality in the remaining sequence of events. And then what happens is that the source E0B sends a message to the target E0B, and this is implemented by an out and in events on both sides of the macros. Typically, such events take a pair where the first item defines which channel to use, and the second item is a tuple or a term defining the data to be exchanged. Now, the target E0B selects a node, and this is implemented by this let such that syntax, which basically says, okay, let A be a variable of type alg, and let's bind its value to let's bind it to a value which satisfies this predicate mem a ue alg. Mem stands for membership, and this is something that we introduced in the declaration. What happens during the analysis is that ProVerif will consider all possible values that satisfy the predicate. Okay, so the next step is to send back the command reply, and this is implemented also by an in and out events, etc. Okay, so now the main process. So basically what we need to do is to set up the initial context. We know that we have some capability sets which is which are shared, so this is implemented like this, and then we have a Kuwasmi key and this keynote B key. And now the instantiation looks like this. So here the exclamation mark, this is the unbounded replication operator, and the vertical line is the parallel composition. What we say here is that, okay, we would like to run in parallel unbounded replication of these processes giving these values. This is quite impressive because ProVerif will attempt to prove the security properties regardless of the number of replication you have. Okay, so now how do we model security properties? So let's first talk about secrecy. So the goal of this handover procedure is to establish keynote B star and to agree on a capability. In order to do that, we add an extra step in our model where we send some kind of secret encrypted with this key. We need to use the key, actually. And then we add a query in the declaration where we check whether the attacker knows the secret. This attacker is a built-in predicate. And then what happens, actually, is that ProVerif will take this expression, will negate it, and will try to prove it. And if it fails to prove that, it means that it will find that it has found a path which leads from the initial state to a state where the predicate actually holds, because it's the negation. And this is basically an attack path. Okay, so the next property, security property, which we checked is authentication, and for this we rely on Gavin Lowe's definition of weak agreement, and this is like, intuitively it's like this. Basically, we want to be sure that whenever we run an instance of the target E node B role, which ended up with certain values for those parameters, we need to make sure that there has been a run earlier of an instance of the user equipment role that has also reached the same values. ProVerif has support for this. We need some kind of events in order to capture these facts. So basically, we require that whenever we trigger a commit event with given values, we require that we have triggered a running event from a UE role instance with the same values. And the corresponding query looks like this. This is called correspondence assertion in the terminology of ProVerif, and this is actually expresses exactly what we want to prove. One may also add events and the queries for the other direction to make sure that we have a mutual authentication. There is also another variant where we require that this mapping is one-to-one or injective, and this is what we refer to as a strong authentication. Okay? Now, this is last property is not really related to security, but it's needed in order to make sure that we actually can run the protocol from the beginning to the end. So we add some kind of reachability events at the end of each process macros, and we query ProVerif for them. So what happens here is that ProVerif will try to prove the negation, and if it fails, it means that it will return a path that goes from the beginning to the end of each process macro. Why we want this is that we need to make sure that we don't have a deadlock somewhere and that our properties, they trivially hold because of a deadlock. Okay. I'm going now to discuss the verification results quickly. So this table shows all the security procedures that we analyzed. And the properties. Well, we looked at the secrecy, weak authentication, and the injective variant to which we refer to as strong authentication. I mean, secrecy and weak authentication was proved as expected. Strong authentication was a little bit more challenging. Basically, the tool didn't terminate in many cases, and we had some falsification for this particular procedure, which I'm going to talk about in my next slide. Okay, let's look closer to this. So this procedure is between the MME and the UE, and basically the MME wants the UE to start to switch to security mode for a protocol called NAS. So this is the initial context. It's defined by a Kwasmi key and a set of capabilities. What happens is that the MME derives some keys, integrity and encryption keys, to be used for this particular protocol, and sends a command which is integrity protected. And now the UE, having the same context, will derive also the same key and replies by a completion message, which is integrity protected and encrypted. And now the problem here is that in the attack which we get, it shows that parallel sessions by honest agents, they are possible in this model. So basically, The UE cannot tell from, if you have parallel sessions running with the same parameters, the user equipment cannot tell which one has sent the received data, because in the message there is nothing which binds this session to these the session which actually did the action to unique thing. Basically, this can be, we have also the same problem on the other side. The MME cannot tell from which session the reply came from. This is can be mitigated by a transaction identifier or a nonce, something which unique or generated in a unique manner for each session. But the problem here is that it's not clear that this is a problem, because we assume that our core network is trusted and that all nodes there, they are honest. So it's very unlikely that an honest MME node will be like running parallel sessions with the same parameters. And this does not affect secrecy at all, actually. Now I reached the conclusion, so I will basically give some insights. On the upside, I mean, we have better understanding of the properties of the protocol designs, and this analysis provides some kind of increased assurance, and we ended up with formal specifications of the procedures that can be used as reference. On the downside, we had to model protocols in isolation. If we integrated everything in the same model, we would have ended up with a huge model, and the tool could not have terminated in that case. Although the language is very expressive compared to other tools, there are still some. It is still limited because we couldn't model aspects related to state. It was difficult to handle non-termination, and sometimes it felt that the attacker model is too powerful. One can think about a restricted attacker model, for example, with a bounded memory or whatever. But in that case, we would lose soundness, but it's not important as long as we can discover bugs. So it can be used as a debugging tool rather than a prover. As a continuation, we plan to analyze the remaining parts of LTE. There are a lot of other security procedures. We also want to make some kind of evaluation of existing tools and comparison. We did partly this in the context of a master thesis, and we're going to publish the results soon. And last but not least, we want to look into stateful verification. There are very few tools which support this. These are two examples, StatVerif and Tamarin. Why stateful verification? It's basically there is a lot of key derivation in LTE networks. Basically, keys are derived from higher level keys in this hierarchy, and also other parameters of the systems. It's important that the input used for the key derivation is unique. The problem is that those parameters, they can be state related. For example, counters are used, identities, sequence numbers, and these parameters, they can be changed by other security they can be changed by other procedure which have nothing to do with security. Yes, this actually concludes my talk. So thank you for your attention.
Okay, hello? Okay, so there were quite a things here, difficult things here. I'm not sure I understood everything of it, but
yeah.
One part I did not understand is what was actually supposed to be secure of the network. Because you said that if the base stations here or network masts
you
were
mean
compromised,
the trust model.
Then the security model falls. So, how difficult is it to actually access this physical infrastructure?
I didn't try. So, when you design protocols, we need to start from some kind of trust model. Okay, so.
But let's say one of these masts are placed on the top of a mountain.
Yeah.
The signal needs to travel from that mast. Is it going possibly over air to another mast? That's not really secure, right?
Yes, the radio access is through the air. So, I mean, the point from this procedure is like to derive keys that are to be used to secure that.
Yes, absolutely. I just need to understand what might be the weakest link in this, because this seems very thought through. But if you can actually disturb the physical network, and securing the physical network is really difficult, then that is a significant attack surface.
Well, in that case, if you cannot provide these guarantees at least, then you cannot really guarantee that the security property, that this will be secure at all. So you need to start from a trust model. So, but then if your trust model doesn't hold, then you cannot really guarantee that you still have
security. Okay, so to be very specific then, yeah. Is there an example where you actually have a secure physical network, or is that an open problem?
An example where we have secure physical network?
Yes.
And I missed the last part.
Is that an open problem, or are we able to secure the physical network at this point?
Yeah, I mean, when I say physically, is that you have locked doors, basically. So you have closed cabinets and this kind of closed environment. So no one can tamper with that. This is what I mean by physically secure. So, I mean, when you place the node station, you should at least protect the processing units so that no one can tamper with it. This is what I mean by physically secure.
Yes, but in reality, one of these masts here will be placed on top of a mountain in a very secluded area.
Can you rephrase? In reality...
Yes.
Thank you. It's very good. Just in relation to your modeling phase using ProVerif, yes. And you are testing some security properties, authentication in particular, could you just elaborate a bit more on that query that you use? Because, you know, to generalize and to probably oversimplify, authentication is a comparison process? Or if you could just elaborate, it would be great query.
Yes, I mean, authentication, there are really lots of definitions. So what we relied on is the definitions by Gavin Lowe. I don't know if you're familiar with his paper from 97. He gave precise definitions of several types of authentication. And one of them is called weak agreement. And basically what you want to prove, you want to authenticate an agent A to B. And then weak agreement is you can think about it like this. Whenever you run an instance of the agent B, you would like to make, whenever you run an instance of the agent B, you want to prove that there has been a run of instance of the role A previously, and that those two instances, they computed or they agree on some values that you can define. So this is the definition that we relied on. And when you can make it stronger by requiring that this mapping between sessions is one-to-one, injective, and that's what we call strong authentication. And then, of course, you have the other direction when you want to authenticate B to A, and you do it in a similar manner. And the basic technique is to add events in your process roles, and these events basically capture, when you want to trigger the fact that you have run an instance and reached some, when you think this is your goal is reached.
Okay, we're going to have to stop here.
Thank you.
Yeah.